Hello, and welcome to this LinkedIn Live event brought to you by Amgen. I'm Carolyn Bertozzi, and I'm a professor of chemistry at Stanford University and a Howard Hughes Medical Institute investigator. I'm also the Baker Family Co-Director of Stanford ChemH, which is a translational molecular sciences institute dedicated to making new medicines. And it's my great pleasure to be here today with Ray Deshaies. He is the Senior Vice President of Global Research at Amgen, and we're going to be talking about a very exciting subject, which is multi-specific drugs and a new era in biopharmaceutical innovation that's on the way, and we're just right now in the midst of it. Hello, Ray.
Hey, Carolyn. It's great to see you again. When's the last time we saw each other? I think it was probably at Howard Hughes Medical Institute back around 2016 or so.
Yeah, some years
ago. So even if it's over a screen, it's nice to see you.
Yeah.
I'm really happy to be here today and to have this opportunity to talk to you about this exciting science, particularly since both you and I have been working in this area. But before we get underway, I have to remind the audience about comments on social media. We have to be mindful of FDA rules on communication, so we ask that everyone please refrain from discussions on specific therapies or specific drug companies. Thank you, and back to you, Carolyn.
Thanks, and I'm really looking forward to the conversation. Let me just say thank you to those people who are tuned in on LinkedIn, and also for those of you in the social community who submitted some questions in advance, where we will be answering some of those as the conversation continues. And if there are other questions or comments, we will answer them as best as we can at the conclusion of the event. So let's get the conversation started. You know, when we think about the modern biopharmaceutical industry and, you know, how did it all begin? And I think a lot of us think back about 100 years to the early part of the 20th century when a medicine was like the molecule aspirin. And since then, as Ray, you outlined so beautifully in your paper published in Nature just a few months ago, that there have been three major waves of innovation in modern drug development. And now we're kind of poised to begin this new fourth wave that we're going to talk about today. So just kind of to give the audience a bit of a preview as to how did we get here? Can you walk us through the first three waves and then talk about what is this new fourth wave?
Sure, I'd be happy to. But let me start with a disclaimer. I'm really referring here specifically to molecular drugs when I talk about the waves. So I'm not talking about cell therapies or gene therapies, which represent their own waves, if you will. And I'm really looking at things where the paradigm for how we looked for drugs or the type of drugs that we look for changed in a really fundamental way, as opposed to just incremental improvement, because there have been many incremental improvements over the years. Now, the first wave was really, as you noted, I think aspirin would be as good a place as any to bookmark the start of the industry. And it was the marriage of, forward pharmacology, conventional pharmacology, with synthetic organic chemistry, where instead of chewing on willow bark, when you had a toothache, for example, you could isolate the active component from willow bark and then learn how to synthesize it, put that into a pill, and that's aspirin. And so that relied on having assays using either cells or tissues or organs or even animals where you could read out some physiological response that correlated with some health outcome. And so that dominated drug discovery for, like seven decades or so, until the 1970s. And then you had the start of a second wave. And in that wave, it was taking advantage of major advances that had happened in biochemistry as well as molecular biology, where now we really started to understand targets that could potentially influence health outcomes. So take as one example, HMG-CoA reductase. That's the rate-limiting enzyme in cholesterol biosynthesis. We had information telling us that high cholesterol in the blood was bad. So if you inhibit that enzyme, you should reduce cholesterol synthesis and thereby reduce cholesterol. And so a number of campaigns were started using the purified enzyme, looking for small molecules that inhibit it. And that led to this whole class of statin drugs that went on to become so successful. That wave has continued to run for the last, 45 years or so. And still, that's how many of our drugs are most commonly sought. You start with a target and you look for a molecule that modulates the activity of the target. The third wave was not a change in how we look for drugs, but the type of drugs that we develop. And that was came on with the advent of the biotechnology revolution, where recombinant DNA methodology had advanced to the point where you could start producing recombinant proteins in hosts like E. coli or yeast or tissue culture cells like Chinese hamster ovary cells. And so that led to a whole new series of drugs of extraordinary potency and tolerability, because they're really natural proteins that the body normally produces anyway. Now, the fourth wave is something completely new, and that's what we'll talk about today. And that's really fundamentally changing the types of drugs that we look for. So in the first three waves, they're all characterized by what I call the one target, one drug paradigm, where you have a target and you have a drug, and the drug interacts with that target through one interface, and that interaction modulates the activity of the target. It either increases the activity or it decreases the activity. And that's pretty much how almost all drugs work. Now, with multi-specific drug, the drug engages two entities, right? So the drug has two different interfaces on it. And I've classified these into two groupings. The first are what I'm calling tether bodies. So a tether body is a drug where one part of the drug tethers it at a particular place in the body, and the other part of the drug acts on a target that carries out the actions of the drug. So an example of a tether body would be an antibody drug conjugate, for example, where the antibody localizes the drug to a specific tissue and then releases the drug to act on the cells in that tissue. Now, the other grouping I'm calling molecular matchmakers. And in a molecular matchmaker, what happens is that the drug brings together two things, one thing being the target and the other being an effector that acts upon the target. And that is really a fundamental change, and it really opens up a lot of exciting new directions.
Yeah, that's fantastic. And it seems like there's so many different ways that you can build a multi-specific drug because they're not constrained by just acting on the one target, but can harness other facets of biology. So can you talk a little bit about how these molecules can behave in a biological system in a way that's just fundamentally different from the one target, one drug? You know, what can they do that's new?
Yeah, so they can do a number of things. So one thing you can do is you can, so there's a lot of natural biological interactions where two proteins normally interact. You can enhance that interaction, you can stabilize it so it occurs more frequently or it lasts longer and you get a stronger biological effect from it. So that's one possible thing that you can do. Another possible thing is that you can create a completely new interaction between proteins that essentially creates new biology. And what you're doing is you're harnessing the power of these mechanisms that have evolved over eons to carry out the biological effect of the drug.
Yeah, that's wonderful. It's a very exciting time. So your team at Amgen has made us an animation to help illustrate the principle of multi-specific drugs. And my understanding is that this is the first time that anyone is going to see this movie.
Yeah, it's the world premiere. And, it's so appropriate because Hollywood is just down the street. So let's take a look. I think it's really a cool movie.
Excellent.
You may be surprised to learn that even though there are thousands of medicines, nearly every drug made has two big things in common. First, conventional drugs are designed to zero in on a single type of protein, which is the target of the drug. Second, the drug itself has to do the hard work by binding to the target and altering its normal activity. The problem is that a lot of targets that lead to disease are what we call undruggable. They don't have the kinds of crevices and pockets that drugs are designed to fill, or they're just too big and tough for one drug to tackle. That's why Amgen believes the future belongs to multispecific medicines that work through a principle known as induced proximity. Instead of trying to grapple with these difficult, undruggable targets on their own, these molecular matchmakers enlist powerful friends to come help them do the heavy lifting. It's a great idea because cells are patrolled by crews of versatile molecules that scientists can enlist to fight disease. For example, we could commandeer the enzymes that tag unwanted or damaged proteins for destruction so that they mark these undruggable targets for elimination. Alternatively, we could give new marching orders to the machines that gobble up cellular debris, or even redirect the molecular scissors that slice and dice RNAs that cause disease. While some of these new ideas are still on the drawing board, in the long run, the potential of multi-specific drugs is truly staggering. By leveraging the power and flexibility of biology, this new approach to drug design could tackle diseases now considered untreatable.
That was a brilliant movie explaining the concept of multi-specifics and induced proximity. And it makes me think about all the nasty targets that are causing diseases that you would just like to chew up with your molecular scissors. And those little creatures were called the undruggable targets. So can you help the audience understand, what do people mean when they say that something is an undruggable target?
Yeah, sure. You know, about 85% of potential targets encoded in the human genome are what we call undruggable because they don't have functional binding pockets that a drug can fit into. So imagine this is your target and it has, you know, it has this part here which does the work of grabbing things. But if you put a drug into there, you stop it from being able to do its job. And that's how drugs typically work. But there's a lot of proteins that work in a different way, you know, that they don't have mouths like that or pockets and different terms that people use. And they may actually serve more as a tether that links one thing to another. And there's nowhere for a drug to easily grab onto to block the activity of that protein. So, you know, multi-specifics offer up completely new possibilities because now, as long as there's a place a molecule can bind, it doesn't have to be a functionally important part. Like, for example, with me, you wouldn't have to stuff a cork in my mouth. You could just attach something to my belly button or any other part of me and then drag me to something else that would then carry out the action. And so, you know, that's what it opens up, a whole new class of targets that we currently don't have the methods to inhibit those targets. And that's what's so exciting about it.
Yeah, I agree. This is a very exciting new modality. And you know, there are so many examples of proximity at work in biological systems. You know, often people will say that biological specificity is 95% proximity. And this applies to signal transduction networks where proteins interact with other proteins to allow a post-translational modification, gene regulation processes. It just seems like there's so many different ways that you could leverage this approach to treat different diseases.
Yeah, exactly, Caroline. Like I said earlier, with induced proximity, you could enhance existing interactions, so stabilize existing interactions so you get more bang for the buck, so to speak. You can replace an interaction that's missing because of a mutation that's causing disease that disrupts the interaction. You know, you could also potentially create new interactions that normally never exist in the cell by bringing together proteins that normally have nothing to do with each other. And if you just consider the number of possible combinations. You have 20,000, roughly 25,000 proteins encoded in your genome. You could potentially make any pairwise combination. So there's millions of possible combinations that you could generate to create new biology to try to control the behavior of cells and tissues and organs.
Yeah, I mean, I've been really excited to see how many different ways people have put functionality together to make multi-specific drugs. And there's several that are already being pursued, as we saw in the video. And as you know, I personally have an interest in this in my lab at Stanford. We think a lot about what are the proteins outside the cell that one might like to target for degradation because of their role in disease. And, you know, we've been developing molecules that we call lysosome targeting chimeras. And the abbreviation we use for that is the LITAC. And these are molecules that have basically multiple functions. On the one hand, they bind extracellular targets. On the other hand, they'll bind a lysosome trafficking receptor. So those are two different functions that normally don't come together for many targets, but we have found ways to put them together. And we published a paper just about a month ago in Nature on this technology. Now, you know, when I use the word LITAC, people might recognize that that's sort of a cousin of one of the original multispecific drug categories, which are the proteolysis targeting chimeras, or the so-called PROTAC molecules. And I'm wondering if you could talk a little bit about these original bispecific molecules and how they work to target their targets for degradation.
Oh, I'd really be happy to. Sure. So as you mentioned, we have the PROTACs, the proteolysis targeting chimeric molecules, and those molecules bring together a drug target and a ubiquitin ligase. And that triggers the attachment of ubiquitin onto the target by the ubiquitin ligase. And that ubiquitin then serves as a signal to degrade the target via the proteasome. So that's a very effective way of ridding the cell of particular proteins that might be causing disease or contributing to disease. So you saw a PROTAC molecule in the animation that ran earlier. Another type of bispecific are what are called bispecific CD3 engagers. And these are conceptually similar to PROTAC molecules in that they induce proximity between a target and an effector. But in this case, the targets and effectors are not molecules, they're not proteins, but they're actually cells where the target is a cancer cell and the effector is a T cell. So CD3, that's part of the name, bispecific CD3 engager, is part of the T cell receptor. And when you bind that, you latch onto a T cell, but not only that, you turn it on. And the other arm latches onto a cancer cell. So now you bring a cancer cell into proximity to a T cell that's switched on, and the T cell will then attack the cancer cell to eliminate it. So the same concept of destroying something that you want to get rid of, but in this case, everything's happening outside of cells, and it involves cells themselves instead of protein molecules. Now, similar to PROTACs, there are ribotac molecules. I'm really excited about those. And those are, they're small molecules that bind an RNA, and they bind an enzyme that degrades RNA. So this is conceptually very, very similar to PROTAC molecules. And it gives you a way of potentially eliminating single RNA species from cells using small molecule drugs, which is just really exciting, opens up a whole new vista in drug discovery. There's also AUTAC molecules. So those are autophagy targeting chimeras where you can induce the engulfment of something inside a cell by an autophagic membrane, which then forms a vesicle, which traffics to the lysosome where that vesicle gets consumed. And so this gives you a way of eliminating not just molecules, but actually even organelles or large macromolecular aggregates from cells by encapsulating them in an autophagic vesicle. And as you noted, there's the work that your lab has pioneered on LITACs, which is, again, you're using the lysosome, but to drag proteins from outside the cell or that are in the plasma membrane and drag them to the lysosome for destruction. And I think, you know, what your work has shown is we're really, our primary limit right now is our creativity and our vision, because there's all sorts of combinations you can imagine besides these few that I've summarized here. And so I think it's going to be really exciting to see how this unfolds, you know, over the next couple of years. You know, the approach itself is incredibly versatile. And as you noted, this idea of inducing proximity is fundamental to a lot of how cellular processes themselves naturally work.
Yeah. And, you know, I'll say as a chemist and a chemical biologist, I find this to be an incredibly exciting time, because these multi-specific molecules and induced proximity platforms, they really come from chemical biology. And I've noticed from interactions with my friends who are synthetic chemists that they also feel kind of a reinvigoration in terms of being creative about ligand discovery. So, you know, in the earlier waves of biopharmaceutical development, chemists were focused on how to make a molecule that binds that enzyme active site, right? That deep pocket. Now, because of PROTAC molecules and AUTACs and RiboTACs, there is a lot more interest in finding ligands for serendipitous cavities on a protein that might not be directly involved in function. And I see that this has motivated new approaches to ligand discovery, like covalent fragment screening approaches, looking at cyclic peptides and sort of non-canonical molecules that, you know, might have been thought of as not drug-like in the past, but we've now figured out how to engineer them to have better properties in vivo. And I'm wondering, you know, how do you see chemistry being influenced by the opportunity of multi-specific drugs?
Yeah, that's a great question. You know, I think this really, it potentially, you know, is opening up a renaissance in chemistry and industry, in that, you know, look, over the past 20 years, there's really been a progressive move towards biologics. And you can see this if you just look in the league tables of the best-selling drugs in the world, where in 2000, it was essentially all small molecules with maybe one or two exceptions. And now it's largely, of the top 20, I think it's now like 14 of them are biologics. Most of those are antibodies. And that's, you know, because of the power and the efficacy, the specificity, the tolerability of these biologics. But now with these chimeras, these targeting chimera molecules, you can imagine, because you're engaging natural mechanisms, you can imagine capturing a lot of the same benefits and efficacy and possibly even tolerability with these kind of molecules. So I think this really opens up broad new vistas. And I'm excited, you know, because Amgen, I feel, is really in a leadership position in this area with our induced proximity platform. And before that, our BiTE molecule platform, where we're taking this approach, you know, with both small molecules in the induced proximity platform, as well as with biologics in the BiTE molecule platform. Now, yeah. Go ahead.
Oh, I'm just looking at your pipeline, and it looks like Amgen has a pipeline that's maybe two-thirds multi-specific drugs. Do I have that right?
Yeah, you know, I sat down one day, you know, I was on a long plane flight from Copenhagen, and I sat, boy, isn't that ancient history, a long plane flight. anyway, I had a lot of time. And so I was looking at our portfolio, and I just started counting up, and I was stunned to see that between what we call early optimization, where we first define a molecule, all the way through to the end of phase one, fully more than two-thirds of our portfolio are multi-specifics. And that just convinces me, you know, that even though there's relatively few that are on the market now, this is a building wave, and it's really going to bring forward because I'm sure Amgen is not unique here. There are a lot of these types of molecules in development throughout industry. So I think we're going to see a real shift. Now, you know, I think this raises the question of why, you know, why are multi-specifics all of a sudden rising up as this major drug category? And I could see two, there's probably multiple answers to that, but I'll just throw two out there. One is that, you know, we've picked, the industry has really picked a lot of the low-hanging fruit, where you have a target that's druggable, that you can make either a small molecule or an antibody against that target and capture a benefit of inhibiting that target. Targets like that have been pursued with tremendous enthusiasm, and there just really are not many of those left sitting around. The second, so the targets to go after now tend to be very challenging, more undruggable, and then you need these new approaches. The other thing is that, to some extent, I think the industry is the victim of its own success. So, you know, for decades now, we've been developing drugs that are, you know, amazingly efficacious and very well tolerated, especially, you know, from the biologics revolution. And, you know, our job in the industry is to innovate and keep doing, you know, advancing beyond what we've done before. But that's getting hard because what we did before was really effective. And so that's, again, I think the multi-specifics, because we can engage natural evolved mechanisms, those have the potential to, you know, to for us to step up our game another notch.
Yeah, those are great points. So, you know, what happens next? There's so many targets to go after now that were previously undruggable. There's so many different effectors that you could bring to bear with a multi-specific molecule. What do you see as some of the opportunities that are in the near horizon for this class of multi-specific drugs?
Yeah, so I think, you know, one very obvious class that's being aggressively gone after right now are these so-called tether bodies that concentrate a drug in a particular location. And, you know, we see a lot of excitement, including a major acquisition. I think it was a couple of weeks ago now, of a company that specializes in antibody drug conjugates. And so that's a really hot area. And I think we're going to see a lot of instances where, you know, people are localizing cytokines, for example, and other hormones to specific parts of the body by using receptors that are localized to specific cell types. And again, that can really concentrate the action of that hormone molecule. So that's one class. And another member of that class, for example, are siRNAs, where you can attach GalNAc, which is a sugar molecule, to an siRNA, and there's a receptor for GalNAc on the liver. So you get very effective delivery of the siRNA to the liver, where you can get very effective silencing of gene expression. So that's one. The other class would be, you know, these molecular matchmakers like PROTAC molecules, molecular glues, which are a kind of PROTAC-like molecule. And, you know, those are still in the very early stages. So I think there's tremendous amounts of innovation that's waiting to happen there. You know, another area that I think is really interesting, and it falls within the tether body class, is the blood-brain barrier. So, you know, I looked at this a while ago, and I think I mentioned earlier that if you look at the best-selling drugs in the world, they're now dominated by biologics, but not if you look at the best-selling drugs that address pathologies in the central nervous system. Those are mainly small molecules. And the reason is that large biologics, you know, large proteins do not readily cross the blood-brain barrier. So we've been unable to bring the power, the specificity, the tolerability of biologics to address diseases of the central nervous system. And I submit if we could do that, you know, it would literally almost create a whole new industry, right? It would explode because now all these targets in the CNS, you could use the power of monoclonal antibody technology, for example, to address them. But we're going to need a way to be able to get those molecules across the blood-brain barrier. And that will require some type of multi-specific. You know, there's a lot of innovation that remains to be done with bispecific CD3 engagers, you know, to to get them to, you know, more specifically target the cells we want to go after. You could think of making all sorts of computational AND gates and OR gates and NAND NOT gates and so forth. So I think there's tremendous amount of innovation that's just waiting to happen.
Yeah, I mean, there's so many ways in which multispecifics could be totally game-changing. I agree. And, you know, again, from the chemist's perspective, it's a huge opportunity for people who are looking for creative new ways to find ligands. Because no matter what you're trying to do with these molecules, you have to have a binder to your target and a binder to your effector. And I noticed that, you know, Amgen has made an investment in leveraging innovative technologies such as DNA encoded libraries. This is a very exciting approach to get at new kinds of chemical matter for ligand discovery. And can you comment on how you see your new investment in DNA encoded library technology as being synergistic with an expansion of your multi-specific drug platform?
Oh, thanks for bringing that up, Carolyn. You know, when we started thinking about induced proximity and thinking about it more generally, one thing that occurred to us is the core element of induced proximity is having a binder, a specific binder, irrespective of whether it modulates the activity of the target. You need that specific binder. And then you have one for your effector, one for your target, you join them together and you have your molecule. So we realized that DNA encoded libraries are, it's almost like the perfect technology to find that, because the way this works is you build libraries like you build Legos. So let's say you have your red Lego, and to that Lego, you have attached a DNA oligonucleotide that's essentially a barcode for that specific red Lego. Then you attach the green Lego to the red Lego, and when you attach it, it also has its oligonucleotide barcode that you join to the existing red one from the first round. And then you attach a blue Lego onto your red-green combination. And again, you have a DNA oligonucleotide that you append to that growing oligonucleotide chain. So now it goes red, green, blue. So now what you do, and you make literally billions of these molecules, and they're all in one little test tube. And so then what you do is you have your target, you have a protein molecule, you put it in that test tube. And if any of those billions of molecules stick to it specifically, you can find them, because what you do is you then add a bead with an antibody that pulls down your target. And then you just look and see what came down with your target. And any molecules in that mix that bind your target specifically will drag along the oligonucleotide that's attached to them. And then you just read them out by sequencing that oligonucleotide, red, green, blue. Okay, that must mean it's this particular molecule. It's like a barcode. And so that's a perfect way for identifying molecules based on their ability to bind. And, you know, we looked the world over and, you know, we came to the conclusion that new evolution based in Copenhagen, and that's why I was in this long flight back from Copenhagen, that they were really, they're among the people who discovered this methodology back 20 years ago. And we felt they were among the best in the world, and they would really, you know, amp up our ability to, you know, to apply this technology to induced proximity to try to make new medicines. And so we're really excited to have them as part of the team.
Yeah, it's incredible for me to think about that image of the little Eppendorf tube as having millions or billions of DNA linked molecules in there. And especially when I think about what a more conventional pharmaceutical screening collection would look like, where the library of 2 million compounds takes up a whole warehouse, right? So that's just game changing. Very exciting to see what comes from that technology. So, you know, multispecifics have enormous potential, and they have such incredible mechanistic capability. I imagine, though, that since, you know, they're quite different structurally from, you know, yesteryear's small molecule drugs, that there probably are some challenges as well with optimizing them and, you know, formulating them, getting them to where they need to be, making sure they have the right specificity and efficacy and low toxicity. And I'm wondering if you can comment a little bit on what do you see as the challenges in developing multispecific medicines?
Yeah, well, that's not hard to answer because, you know, drug development is incredibly challenging. There's always difficulties. You know, I like to tell the team, you know, folks, this is not rocket science. It's actually a lot harder than rocket science. Yeah. I think making drugs, and I'm sure, you know, you probably experienced this as well, Carolyn, with the startups you've been involved with, that it's possibly the single hardest intellectual activity that human beings engage in. You know, the body, human body is so complex, and making something that you can put into the body that finds one particular target and changes the activity of that target without doing anything else and sits around long enough to have a therapeutic benefit, that is just very difficult to do that. So, you know, what makes these even potentially more difficult than normal drugs is you don't have to worry with a normal drug. Remember, one target, one drug, you know, you just have one interface to worry about. With these molecules, by definition, you have multiple interfaces, so that multiplies the complexity. So, you know, these are, you know, they're going to be inherently more complex, and that's going to affect their generation, their optimization, their pharmacokinetics, how long they last in the body, their tolerability, their manufacture, their clinical development, and even their commercialization. And, you know, there is an increased propensity because of their complexity, especially if they're biologics. You know, they tend to have an increased tendency for proteolysis to aggregate with each other, which makes them physically less stable. That leads to poor yields and in general makes manufacturing more difficult. Often these chimeric proteins that are bispecifics and multispecifics are more efficient at eliciting anti-drug antibodies. So the body can make antibodies to neutralize the drug. And that can make it difficult to evaluate them in animal toxicology studies. It can be hard to find animal models because already when you're looking at the mouse, which is what we most often use, the mouse protein is different enough from the human target that the drug doesn't interact with it. Well, now you have to, it's not just interacting with one thing, it has to interact with two different things in the mouse. So you sort of double your chances that your molecule will not be able to work in the mouse. So models become more difficult. So, you know, all around, I think they're going to be more challenging. But on the other side of that hill, if you will, there's the potential for them to be, you know, much more powerful mechanistically because of their ability to piggyback on evolved mechanisms.
Right, yeah. You know, it makes me think back 100 years ago, drug discovery was largely about chemistry. And then biology came into the mix and it became very much about chemistry and biology. And here we are, and we have new tools at our disposal that we can bring to bear on the problem of drug development. I'm thinking engineering technologies, computational and structural modeling technologies. And I'm wondering, are these going to be helpful as we try to solve some of the challenges that are inherent to the multispecific drug?
Absolutely. I think as you've, you know, very correctly noted, the success of our industry has really hinged on this successful marriage of biology and chemistry. And that's at the core of almost everything we do in this industry. But looking to the future, I think we can potentially benefit from other sciences, or we will benefit from other sciences as well. As you've noted, engineering, and just one simple example, devices, you know, increasingly, you know, we have self-administered devices that deliver drugs subcutaneously that we can just ship to the person so they don't have to go to a doctor. And that involves a lot of device engineering to deliver the right amount of drug at the right time, at the right dose, in a way that, you know, is comfortable for the patient. You know, there's many other applications you can think of. You know, let's start with AI, for example. You know, the way we look for small molecules currently is, you know, we synthesize literally thousands of different derivatives to try to find the one that will impact our target. And if we now go to multi-specifics, again, it makes that more complicated because we have to engage two different things or more. And, you know, could we use machine learning and AI to really short circuit that extremely cumbersome search, you know, where we're making thousands of different permutations to find the right molecule. So, you know, those are just two examples, but, you know, I think we really, you know, we will really benefit from the convergence of different branches of science to help us build the best, most sophisticated, most active, best tolerated drugs so that we can deliver the highest value to patients.
Yeah, that's so exciting. There's so much potential, so much promise. And, you know, the thought of bringing together all these disciplines to solve these kinds of problems is kind of what gets me up in the morning. And I know that it gets you up as well. We're coming up on our time. So let me just sort of close it out by saying thank you once again, Ray, for this really interesting conversation. This is going to conclude our LinkedIn Live broadcast. I appreciate all of you who signed in from the audience for joining us today, and I hope you found this as interesting and inspiring as I have.
Oh, thanks, Carolyn. You know, I always look forward to talking to you, and even more, I look forward to reading your next paper. You know, I thought your LIHTC paper was fantastic and really moved the field forward.
Thank you. It would be an honor.
If anyone would like to know more about multispecifics and induced proximity, please visit the Amgen Science website and social media accounts. You can even rewatch that animation, but it won't be the world premiere that next time. And you could learn about the innovative research that we're doing and the technologies that Amgen is bringing to the fight against disease. So take care and see all of you next time.